George Frideric Handel was to become the most important composer in England in the 18th century. Whether or not he was in fact an English composer is a subject for scholarly debate. But in any case, Rinaldo was the first opera he produced for his long career in England, performed for the first time in the Haymarket at the Queen's Theatre, February 1711. The artistic culture of London at this time was in a period of transition. John Dryden had died in 1700. Many of the great Restoration playwrights had either retired or died. The musical world is unsettled also. Purcell had written his semi-operas, King Arthur and The Faerie Queen, at the beginning of the last decade of the 17th century. Purcell dies in 1695, and no one really has arrived to take up the mantle. He was known as the English Orpheus, and when Handel comes on to the English scene in 1711, he is described in the preface to the libretto of Rinaldo as the Orpheus for our age. He's not called the English Orpheus, but he is called the Orpheus for our age, and he is taking over essentially the role of Purcell as the principal composer. Handel arrives in London in the autumn of 1710. He's 25 years old, but he is very experienced. As a young man, age 12, he announced to his family that he was dedicating himself to all the liberal arts. He was trained then as an organist. He, having mastered the organ, moved to Hamburg to learn about theatrical composition. And then he went, as did all composers of the day, to Rome to learn how to write melody. And he is very prolific in this period. He produces some 40 cantatas, several oratorios, a number of organ pieces, and most importantly, the opera Agrippina, which is premiered in Venice in 1708. It's a major piece for a major opera house. It gives him an immense amount of exposure. And so he was invited by a number of British diplomats and tourists from Britain to come and make his fortune in England. But he did not immediately. In fact, he returned to Hanover, his home base, where he was to be employed by the Elector George Ludwig, the future George I of England. And it's interesting that he goes back to Hanover because Hanover doesn't have, it's a small court, it doesn't have an operatic culture at all. But George was willing to employ him and to give him a kind of preliminary sabbatical. That is, he was able to go wherever he wanted for a year. And so, having taken the post as court composer at Hanover, he then moves to England and becomes immediately engaged in the production of Rinaldo. John Vanbrugh designed the Queen's Theatre in the Haymarket in 1705, and the manager of that theatre was a young entrepreneur about the same age as George Frideric Handel named Aaron Hill. Aaron Hill was hoping for a hit, and he as much as says in the preface to the libretto, "I have chosen this story because it has already succeeded all over the world as the subject for operas in various tongues." It comes, the story of Armida and Rinaldo, from the poem by the Italian poet Torquato Tasso. It's published in 1581. It's translated then into English in 1600, and it becomes the text for multiple musical versions by Lully, later by Gluck, by a number of now forgotten composers. But Hill chose it because he knew that it was likely to succeed. The story of the opera is essentially a struggle for control of Jerusalem. A story from the First Crusade, the battle between the Christians and the Saracens. The principal hero of the poem is Godfrey of Boulogne. His confederate is Rinaldo. They are opposed by Armida, the queen of Damascus, but Hill complicates the story considerably by giving Godfrey a daughter, Almirena, who is the love interest for Rinaldo, and by also giving the witch Armida herself a confederate, Argante. The reason for his tweaking of the story in this way is probably a function of the cast of singers he needed to employ. So he adds variety and complexity and gives work to the singers, as well as increasing the dramatic possibilities. The musical scene in London at the end of the 17th and beginning of the 18th century was enriched immeasurably by an influx of Italian singers. One of the most important of these was the castrato Niccolo Grimaldi, known as Niccolini, who arrives in 1708. In a time when an average annual wage may have been £50 for a year, Niccolini was paid £2,000 for his services to the Italian opera. There were Italian composers as well, particularly Giovanni Bononcini, who was to become Handel's rival for the next two decades. And naturally, this group of artists and their direction of taste began then to provoke a reaction. In Aaron Hill's preface to the libretto of the opera, he explains his motive in wanting to naturalize the Italian style, to make it acceptable to English audiences. And one of the things that the opera needs, according to Hill, is spectacle. As he says, the deficiencies I found, or thought I found, in such Italian operas as have hitherto been introduced among us were, first, that they had been composed for tastes and voices different from those who were to sing and hear them on the English stage, and secondly, that wanting the machines and decorations which bestow so great a beauty on their appearance, they have been heard and seen to very considerable disadvantage. Therefore, Hill sets about to remedy this lack of spectacle. Rinaldo was a huge success, but that doesn't mean that everybody was pleased at its success. This is, after all, the age of satire in London, and Joseph Addison in The Spectator had some very cutting things to say about the opera, beginning with the business of the birds. Addison writes, about walking the streets about a fortnight ago, I saw an ordinary fellow carrying a cage full of little birds upon his shoulder. And as I was wondering with myself what use he would put them to, he was met very luckily by an acquaintance who had the same curiosity. Upon his asking him what he had upon his shoulder, he told him that he had been buying sparrows for the opera. Sparrows for the opera, says his friend, licking his lips. What, are they to be roasted? No, no, says the other. They are to enter toward the end of the first act and to fly about the stage. In fact, there have been so many flights of them let loose in this opera that it is feared the house will never get rid of them, and that in other plays they may make their entrance in very wrong and improper scenes, so as to be seen flying in a lady's bedchamber or perching upon a king's throne, besides the inconveniences which the heads of the audience may sometimes suffer from them. This is one of the most famous reviews in music history. What's interesting is that we aren't even sure that Addison went to see the show. He would have had some cause for professional jealousy, he himself having written a libretto a couple of years earlier. But in any case, despite the vitriol, despite his attacking Aaron Hill's, one of Aaron Hill's spectacular effects, this satire didn't stop the public from coming to see Rinaldo since it was the hit of the season. It's part of the musical myth that Handel composed Rinaldo in a matter of 2 weeks. And in fact, Rossi mentions in his preface to the libretto how he could scarcely keep up with Mr. Handel. The pertinent fact here is that Handel was recycling material. About one third of Rinaldo is entirely new composed, but two thirds comes from some of Handel's earlier pieces that he had composed in Italy, pieces which were not published and which had not been performed in England. So Handel refits them for the purposes of this new opera. In fact, some of the most famous and beautiful moments in the opera are pieces that Handel took from his earlier work. Now, this doesn't mean that he simply shoved them into the new opera as they were. There is evidence that he tweaked them, that he changed certain phrases, that he made certain accommodations based on who was to sing the part. But still, it's a pretty fast job. London was full of many, many very talented orchestral instrumental players. And finding these forces available, Handel used them with extraordinary ingenuity in composing the score of Rinaldo and of revising a number of the pieces that he was importing from his previous work. For example, in Or La Tromba, the great martial number that Rinaldo sings in the last act, Handel uses four trumpets. No one has done this before. We get an extraordinary look at both Handel's talent and at his opportunism by looking at his arrangement of the music at the end of Act Two. Normally, we would expect that the end of an act, that an act would conclude with a great solo by one of the major figures. And in fact, this is the case frequently in Handel's other operas and in Acts One and Act Three. But at the end of Act Two, Handel has written for himself a cadenza to be played from the keyboard in the midst of Armida's aria ending that act. Handel was as famous for a time as a keyboard player as he was as a composer, and therefore he presents himself, he provides himself with an opportunity to shine, to show off at the end of the second act. One of the things that you see immediately in Rinaldo is Handel's extraordinary sense of drama, his ability to use music for dramatic purposes. And the clearest way of talking about this probably is to talk about his innate sense of rhythm, both in the particular the creation of the rhythm of an aria, for example. You get some of these pieces in your head and you can't get them out. But then also in the overarching sense of rhythm, that is, the use of antithesis of an intimate moment and then a kind of heroic moment, counterpoint between simplicity and complexity. None of Handel's competitors could match him in his great sense of dramatic structure. He also had an extraordinary ability to use music for characterization. The simplest example of this, I suppose, would be Armida's entrance in the number 48, Terribili, in which you get a sense of the monstrosity, the power, and the seductiveness. There is also his ability to use music for the suggestion of complex personality, with Rinaldo in particular, in a number of the laments in Cara Sposa, for example. You get a sense of uncertainty, of frailty, that makes the character much more interesting than the kind of pasteboard heroic figure that one might have expected. This opera is of particular interest because it was Handel's first opera written for London. It was the first exposure of his great talent in the British Isles. But it's also interesting that this, of course, is the 300th anniversary of the premiere. One of the things that accounts for the success of Rinaldo is quite simply Handel's unparalleled ability to write a great popular tune. The March for the Christians in Act Three became a popular number of the day. And then there are those great laments. For example, Lascia ch'io pianga, Almerena's great lament. Nobody writes tunes like that. And that's one reason that we're still listening to this opera today.